another one where it's
No, it's a great space.
We're having a conversation.
We're just waiting for 2 minutes. There's some people coming from the hallway.
They took it down now.
Yeah.
This is supports the bridge as like as the two ends and draw cement in there and mix it all. Yeah, it's great.
Okay, so we started a discussion. We started a discussion on the stage, and that's great. You're going to meet our guests in a few moments, and Jessica will introduce them. I'm going to introduce myself and tell you why we are doing this session tonight. There's a reason. I'm Nancy Singer. I'm the executive director of the Cahilla Residential Program, and Cahilla is all about affordable housing. We have over 500 units in our portfolio. And we are trying to help those in our community that are living in poverty, and there are over 24,000 that we know of. So it's a fairly large number. We're also, we have a rental assistance program, which is supported by private developers. And that's gone extremely well, and that offers immediate assistance. We created Sukkaville, which is an event, not a program, 5 years ago, and it's our creative response to raise awareness for the need for permanent affordable housing. And this is year five, and we're going to be down at Nathan Phillips Square on September 25th to the 27th. And if you come down, you're going to see some pretty amazing structures that are temporary. They're sukkahs to commemorate the holiday of Sukkot, which we celebrate this time of year. And they are being built to promote the need, again, for permanent affordable housing, to raise awareness to the issue in the city overall. So it's a very creative exercise. And it's international, and we have finalists from around the world, this year from Sweden and Italy. And we have a stellar jury. And it's a very exciting event. We have tried for, I guess Dan and I have a bit of history. Dan is not one of the finalists, so there will be 8 sukkahs on the square and a few more that we're bringing back, previous winners. And Dan is one that we're really excited about showcasing this year. And it's thanks to our partnership with the Koffler Center, we could not have done it otherwise. Dan and I have history. We've actually, Sukkaville's been around for 5 years, for the last 3 years, I've tried to get his sukkah interpretation funded. We have written proposals together unsuccessfully until the Koffler this year came to the rescue and commissioned the piece. And it's extremely significant because what it will be constructed of or from is discarded. I use that word loosely, discarded, right? Is that good?
Discarded, for sure.
Condo sale signs. So the sandwich boards that you see on the street when they're selling condos, of which many are being sold in our city, and many are being built. And condos and condo buildings themselves are symbolic of the unaffordable housing for many in our city. They do not represent affordable housing. This is a different interpretation, taking those signs and making it into a structure, I think, that will raise a lot of comment and excitement. And so I'm very excited about seeing when it's constructed, because I've seen the plans for a long time and I want to see the real thing. And I'm also excited about hearing the conversation tonight between the two guests that we have on the stage, and David and Dan, and just in conversation. I think this is going to be great. So thank you. Thanks for coming.
Take this opportunity to welcome all of you as well. I'm Jessica Darrow Kaplan, and I'm the Director of Public Programs for the Koffler Center of the Arts. So on behalf of the Koffler, I just wanted to welcome you all here and also introduce our featured guests. We are very thankful for the partnership with MOCCA and the opportunity to present this artist talk tonight. So to my left, we have David Liss, who some of you probably know is the Artistic Director and Curator at MOCCA. He contributes greatly to the Canadian landscape of contemporary art, and through both his insightful curation at MOCCA for, I guess, over 15 years as well as his many published art reviews, essays, and exhibition publications. And after 10 successful years here on Queen Street, actually just down the street, MOCCA is moving into its new permanent home in a former factory space on Sterling Road, scheduled to open...
Spring 2017.
There we go. And here is Dan Bergeron, our Toronto-based visual artist that Nancy was talking about, whose work blends street aesthetics with a lot of meaningful community engagement. I've been fortunate to have had the opportunity to work with Dan in different contexts, both in 2008 and 2011 in conjunction with the Luminato Festival. And when Nancy talked about and came to the Koffler with this idea of working with Dan and commissioning him to design the MOCCA, I jumped at the opportunity. Without further ado, I think on that note we should get started with the conversation.
Well, thank you very much to the Koffler Center and to MOCCA Bill for inviting Dan and I here. Dan, as some of you may know, very well-known street artist, we could call you if we were in that category, who's exhibited his work all over Toronto and around the world, including at MOCCA. But Dan's big claim to fame is whenever we need to do a paste up on a wall in the gallery at MOCCA, we call Dan to come over and do that.
It's true.
So what I'd like to get to in this conversation, Dan, is to understand how a young skate punk from growing up in West Toronto, a Gentile, one of the OGs of street art here in Toronto, or actually anywhere, gets invited to do a project for MOCCA Bill. So I'd like to see how we can draw that line, because initially when the invitation was extended to me, I thought, oh, that's Dan Bergeron's doing a MOCCA, really? How is it? I think it's interesting. I think it's a very astute invitation. But a little bit about how you started out, Dan. I should also mention too, we have some images here. We're not doing a slide lecture, but the images will go around a few times, I think. This is some of Dan's work over the years. So you went from, you were a skater.
Yeah.
But then how did you get into art? Did you start with graffiti? Is that?
No. So I've been skateboarding since I was 8. I just turned 40 6 weeks ago. Hurts a little bit more when I fall and skateboard down.
So you're still skating?
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, yeah,
absolutely.
Right.
I built a concrete ramp off the back of my garage for my kids to learn how to drop in on. So I've been through skateboarding. I was exposed to a lot of different art just by way of graphics for the skateboards and through magazines. But then when I started going skateboarding, like in the city, you know, outside of my neighborhood, it was noticing graffiti and seeing graffiti. And then some of the older kids that I skated with, they got into graffiti. I didn't really go that way. I didn't pick up Kansas spray paint and start painting with them. I really appreciated with them. I would go take photos of them when they would do it and stuff. But it was just, I didn't dabble in that regard. But I really respected it and understood it, and thought it was an interesting contribution to public space. And there was a lot more space available back when this was happening in the late 80s, early 90s, when I was really first discovering this, right? Toronto was not what it is now. Probably not until university is when I really started taking my own risks.
What did you go to university for?
I went to university for film. My interest was I wanted to be a director, direct films, starting with documentaries. I thought would be a good foray into directing, and that got me to accomplish that. I went to film school, but I really got interested in photography. And I thought I have to really understand how to capture images and tell a story with one single image before I can make moving images. And through that, I was really interested in darkroom processing, making my images, but I was not interested in putting my images in a frame. I thought that was completely boring. Why would I do that? Everyone else is just putting their photograph in a frame. Thought I was taking some of the photographs I was taking out of context, because they were now in this, like, you know, hopefully if you got into being a gallery, you'd be in this, you know, white cube or whatever, and it's, how does the photo then relate to who the person was that I photographed or where I took it? So I started to take my prints out of the darkroom, pretty big, like up to 30 by 30 inches, and turn them into stickers, and then I started putting them up around the city. And then, you know, that wasn't big enough for me. I wanted to go bigger, so I started to print on paper. And,
so this would be around, was it like early 90s?
No. That was like probably like 99.
Oh, okay.
Is when I first started.
So street art, I guess, was in the U.S. was kind of underway by then. Were you influenced by that? Were you looking at that? Is that what kind of motivated you to get out there? Was that was just your thing? That's just what you wanted to do.
My biggest influence in terms of seeing street art from somewhere else was when I was in university. I took a bunch of trips over to London, because my roommate in university, a good friend of mine, Mark Kinnich, his sister and her husband, they lived in London. So I knew the family really well, and his sister would be like, you know, or Mark would be like, let's go over there, we have a place to stay. And going over there, it was just like the graffiti, or, you know, like, it was, you know, people were calling it street art. No one was calling it street art here.
No.
It didn't exist like that, right?
Yeah.
But I would go over there, and it was completely different than what was happening here. Here it was graffiti, so it was like burners, tags, throw-ups. But there it was like people were doing wheat pasting, postering. You know, some of that was happening in New York, because I had made trips down in New York around that time too, but not like in London. It was completely different.
That was pretty Banksy too, I guess.
That was like when he was first getting up, like, because I remember the first trip I went over to London, I saw someone's work, and he used to put out these little books that were like 4 by 5 inches or something like that, soft cover. And he funded them himself, because I guess he started selling his work, but he's very, you know, do-it-yourself type of guy. He made 30,000 copies of these little books. And so I saw someone's work, and then I was in a bookstore, and I saw one of the books, right? So I got the book. And actually, the first time I went over, first night in London, I went to a show with his work, because my friend over there used to, he was a rep for Appleton, and they were serving drinks at the party, right? So I went to this, you know, I didn't know anything about anything, right? And I went and was like, who's this guy? I wish I had bought a piece from that show.
Like, yeah, you do.
Yeah. It'd be worth $5,000 or more. So, so it was a heavy influence. I'd definitely say he was a big influence on me. But just it was just such a different feeling walking the streets of London, because it seemed like it was more inclusive in terms of what you were allowed to put up, whereas here, because all people did was they just did graffiti here, which I like, but it's kind of the same thing after a while, right? But there was all these different ways that people were expressing themselves.
So when you came back from London, is that when were you inspired?
Yeah, it really pushed me more. Like I had like kind of like started putting these stickers up on my photographs, but like I had no context into who else was doing that or anything. And I went there and was like, holy shit, there's, you know, other people doing this, and there's a whole movement and there's a scene. You know, and then you start making connections with people because you might see someone's email on one of the pieces they put up or whatever, right? And then you like email this person and you meet people. And there was a real scene that was building. It's kind of like I equate...
those images are flying by now.
People always talk about, if you listen to hip-hop, the golden age of hip-hop, right, in the 90s, and like there was a golden age, I think, for street art. Street art's kind of like... I mean, it's almost dead in a way. I see all the people who are really...
Well, I don't know. In some ways, it's kind of... It's bigger than it's ever been. Well, maybe the original Spirit or something like that, like Shepherd Fairey, I guess. He was starting up in the early 2000s as well, right?
Well, he's been up since the 80s. He's been getting up.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, yeah.
He's starting, he's like 10?
No, he's... I think he's like in his... about 46 or something.
Oh, my
but
God.
He started pretty early.
Almost my age.
He started pretty early when he was going to Rhode Island School of Design.
Oh, okay.
Street art is not, there was a really active time, and it probably, you know, maybe even up to like 2009 was still like really quite interesting. But what's happened, I think, is that it kind of went mainstream, especially after Exit Through the Gift Shop or through that time period.
Yeah.
And a lot of what's street art now is muralism, right? So there's all these festivals around the world in cities, and people, these cities host these festivals, or not.
Well, yeah, JR coming over here to Toronto for Nuit Blanche.
Yeah.
She's got a number of projects going up around the city.
Yeah.
Well, it's interesting what you say about that, you know, the kind of, like, what, mainstream or whatever, but, you know, this was an illegal activity back then, man.
Yeah, no, for sure. And I think part of it is that, and like even myself, I took a break from doing illegal works. My wife and I, we had two kids, you know, the past 4 years, bought a house, renovated, did these different things, and I was getting different larger scale projects. But I really made an effort this past summer to go back to doing illegal works, because I think if anyone's going to call me a street artist, or if I even want to refer to myself that way, which I don't necessarily do, I kind of call myself a public artist now, but I think illegal work and street art, like, you can't be going to mural festivals, painting murals, and saying you're a street artist. That's bullshit.
So when did you then, you know, let's say go from the, you know, modest size stickers to something like this, some of these larger scale things that you've done? Where did that kick in?
Well, I started to do bigger wheat paste maybe in 2006, and then I got interested in billboards, because I just thought it was like an untapped space in the city that...
I think people that paid for those billboards wouldn't necessarily see them as untapped space.
Well, I would counter that when I did some of these billboards, they actually got more publicity for the products that I was like reconfiguring the ads on. I mean...
But what was your motivation for that? I mean, I've seen some, you know, the billboards. I mean, there's you and some of the other, you know, billboards, the alteration, shall we say, of billboards became an aspect of street art, I guess, at one point. And I think there's a subversiveness to it, and even graffiti, I think, so, you know, there was, and it's still in the minds of some graffiti artists. It's some kind of a subversive or rebellious act, I don't know if it's a reclamation of urban public space.
Sure,
there's
different ways you can look at it. If you're looking at it like as a straight graffiti, you know, mentality, it's just about getting up, taking over space, right? Some graffiti artists take it to a different degree and think of it as it's a political act. When you're doing something that's, you know, taking over the space that is...
Do you see the billboards or your occupation of public space, or I guess it's private space if it's a billboard, right? I mean, there's a funny line
there between
public
and
billboard. Private space.
Some of the billboards are owned by the city,
yeah.
Actually.
But do you see your actions as a political act or purely artistic, and that happens to be your canvas?
I just think I've kind of, and I didn't realize this until maybe after 7 or 8 years of doing these works, you know, working in public space, that it kind of really goes back to me skateboarding. So, you know, when I was a kid skateboarding, there's a couple of parks, but not really. There's a couple of indoor ones, there's the Duke of Connaught to go to, but really we started street skateboarding, right? Your neighborhood, you expand that, you know, your parents give you a little bit more of a leash, go further, you might not tell them, you keep going further, and then it was like all around the city, right? And that's how I discovered the city. But virtually, I mean, skateboarding was illegal. You know, anywhere we'd skateboard, we could get tickets, we're just told to go away, we're a public nuisance, all these things. And as a skateboarder, you're interpreting the infrastructure, the built environment, on how you want to interact with it by way of your skateboard, as opposed to a pedestrian who just looks at that stair set to walk up the stairs to get to this, you know, because the building owner decided to put the plaza this high above the street level, there's a staircase there, so I'm supposed to walk up to it to get into my office, right? Or I'm going to sit on this bench. But as a skateboarder, you look at these things, like how you can interact with it and challenge yourself in terms of moving spatially through your environment, right? And in terms of creating art, I think working in public space, that's kind of the way that I approach it. And I really realize that it all kind of comes back to me and how I think of the city. And I think of the city as like a space of possibilities where there's all these things that are built and constructed, but I don't want to just interact with those things by the way I'm told to. I think I should interact with them by the way that I feel or how I'm inspired. And then getting back to some of the works that I've created, like, I mean, there's so many different ways I've made work or reasons why I've made work. Some of them, you know, like the price of gas went up. So I did this billboard that was about that. You know, that referred to the price of gas. You know, it's the same commodity, but all of a sudden, even though you have the same amount of it, it's not as much more scarce, you're just going to pump the price up, right? You're just, so I did a billboard about, you know, related to that. We'll see it in one of the slides. There's a billboard that I did where it was like George Bush's reaction to Kanye saying that George Bush doesn't like black people. So that's kind of me maybe as like a cartoonist, you know, if you open the newspaper, there's a political cartoon, right?
Political satire. You can see some of this political satire, some of these pieces.
For sure, yeah. Like, and not trying to be too heavy-handed in anything I do, because I don't think that's a good way to necessarily open a conversation, right? Like, okay, so this is...
Some of them are funny.
Yeah, so like this is, you know, like there's a pressure when you're in your 30s, if you're a couple, to have kids, right? And that whole idea with the baby was like, that was a plastic baby that it was a practice baby, right? So you can have all this similar enjoyment of being childless, you know, but have this baby when you want around to kind of like say, hey, I got a baby, but you know, you're not gonna have to change diapers or, oh, you dropped the baby, that's okay. It's Carl's school, right? So there was a website for that too, which is actually pretty interesting. But, I found some crazy baby cages you could buy in Russia for your kids.
And again, you're moving through the environments, I guess, in your own terms, maybe. Again, public space is, you know, it's very regulated, what's allowed to be presented and what's not, or...
Why is it allowed to be presented? Because someone bought that space, right, or leased it,
yeah,
or whatever, right?
Yeah, so it's, you know...
So how is that, you know,
it's always, it's an economic equation, who gets to put up and who doesn't, I guess in your case... you know, as an artist or an individual citizen, probably couldn't afford to put up a billboard on your own necessarily.
No.
But I think there's, you know, to want to express yourself in a public environment like that, I mean, I often want to, you know, say things about the environment and about politics. I've got a lot of messages out there that I think need to be expressed. I mean, I don't get around it. I might climb up on a billboard and devise some clever scheme that, you know, people are going to read now.
You could come up with a clever scheme. You might want to talk and install.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. All right. Yeah. I'll just come up with the idea, Dan.
Yeah.
You execute. So there. So again, it's a way to reclaim space. Can we say that, or shift the conversation in public,
or even start a conversation? I saw my friends who were creating graffiti, and I thought it was really interesting, and I liked that they were contributing. They're doing something in public space, right? But I just didn't feel that was suited to me. So,
graffiti's often it's an internal conversation. I mean, graffiti artists are often, because again, it's not necessarily legible to the average person.
For sure.
I mean, this is kind of an esoteric vocabulary, and they're all communicating.
It's made
for
other graffiti writers, really.
Yeah, yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and the colors and all, you know, some of it looks cool and all that, but the street art and specifically the street art you were putting up, the billboards in particular were a little more than that.
Yeah, well, I didn't just want to speak to an inclusive community. I wanted everyone to be involved in that conversation. I thought that was just an interesting way that I can contribute something to how we think about public space, an idea that I might have, something that's in the news, you know, a different point of view. And then with the billboards too, a lot of, at the time, it's changed a lot now, but a lot of billboards were illegal anyway. So it's like this billboard didn't even have a permit, and the person who owns the infrastructure is then leasing that infrastructure out every month to a different advertising buyer, right, a media buyer. So it's like, okay, well.
Well, I think that was part of the Beautiful City project. I think it got exposed. I don't know. I can't remember. But there was some, you know, discussion in the media that rather large percentages of billboards around Toronto that were illegal because they exceeded the guidelines and the measurements for billboards.
Well, they just, not even that, they just never got a permit. They just went to the location, just kind of like how I would operate, and sized it up, and like, okay, if you put
this
here,
a good spot for billboard.
Let's put
a massive billboard beside the gardener. That's an awesome idea.
But you know what I mean? Like, who's going to question that we're putting this here?
Yeah.
If we approach it, we go with the trucks and everything, and have all the right equipment, no one's really questioning it. So a lot of the billboards actually didn't even have, they weren't supposed to be there, never mind the size.
So that was, and also I guess the kind of the way you worked, I think, you know, I think I've asked you somewhere along the line in our conversations, I said, oh, so I kind of assume maybe you go in there at night?
No. I did at first, I worked at night because I thought that was the best way to do it. And no, I work during the day because that's my job. I'm approaching it like it's my job, and I kind of go during the day because then I blend in. Because then I'm the guy doing whatever I'm doing, right? It's like, oh, there's a guy working the billboard. He must be the guy that installs the billboard. Or if I'm doing a wall work.
The wall works are different. Let me, you know, kind of just switch it up a bit there. But, you know, a few images are going by here. They're figurative works.
Yeah.
Now, are these portraits? Is that what? Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Portraits. Full figure portraits. Were some of those your own initiative? Were some of those commissioned, or is that a little later on in the evolution after the billboards? Or
no, I was doing portraits of people at the same time I was doing billboards. It was just two different ways I wanted to work.
So why? What's so we understand a little bit about the billboards now. There's a statement there. You're playing with language. It's a visual vocabulary. The figures and the images.
Yeah. I just thought it was cool. You know, like, and again, if we go back to graffiti, a graffiti artist is going to write their tag, even if they're doing a piece or a mural or whatever. So I didn't really, my work wasn't about putting my name up there. And I kind of thought, well, like, who's out there that I'm doing this for? It's people. So it's, why don't I document people and the neighborhoods they live in or spaces that they occupy and put their image up? And then thinking about advertising, because I had done billboards, I mean, this stuff is happening back and forth, kind of. Right, as I'm working.
There's one.
That's a little different. That's a tile piece. So, but like these pieces on walls that are like these wheat paste. It's a juxtaposition against advertising, right? These works are as well, because in advertising, when you see ads, the people in the ad, it's changed definitely from when I started, you know, to where we are now, but it was traditionally like, you know, pretty white people, right? So I kind of was like, well, why don't, what if I'm putting different people up, it's it's just kind of like putting a focus on other groups of individuals. Or
so how did you, we just saw a few of those images go by, so how did you meet these people? You said people from neighbor, are these people you knew, or how did you?
People I knew, right? It was a good way for me to start with people I knew in my neighborhood, right? But then it's like, when you're going to put up work, you know, I'm doing a billboard, I might meet somebody. Or that you're just being observant. It's like, because I do come from a background of photography, and I've shot portraits of all kinds of people, and I did it more as a job. I mean, it was a hobby that turned into a job, and I would shoot portraits for magazines and stuff like that, or celebrities or musicians. And so I had that eye, right? Like when I go in space to like, well, this person's, who's this person? And I like talking to people, so I'd go talk to them, right? And then I'd talk to them a while, and it's like, hey, this is what I do. Could I shoot your portrait? And then that kind of has become a different part of my practice where I've got commissions to do, like,
large. Well, a lot of your work then took a shift into, let's call it community engagement.
Sure, yeah. I mean, I think that all my work is interested. It's not necessarily community engagement, some of it's city engagement, right? Because it's more of a, for the whole city, but it's really about connecting with people who are walking the streets. But then with these projects where I go into a specific neighborhood or community, yeah, that's
where we were invited into the these projects that you were projects.
Yeah, absolutely. Like Jessica mentioned with Luminato, one of my first really big projects was in 2008 in Regent Park. So we worked with Devin Ostrom was the curator. You mentioned Beautiful City. He was also behind that. And he said, you know, like, here's your space, Regent Park, what do you want to do? So, you know, I thought
that's pretty open.
I thought about the fact that I was shooting portraits, and that at the time it was Regent Park was just really coming into the news in terms of the redevelopment happening. Even though it's been planned for, you know, since 2002, it's been in the works and all these things. 2008 it was like, well, now it's really starting to really happen, right? And everyone was interested in the value of the land, right? It's the biggest part of the most valuable piece of land in Canada near downtown center that's going to be redeveloped, right? But people weren't focusing on the people, which I thought was interesting. So I immediately said to Devin, well, why don't I take portraits of people and put their images up on the buildings where they live, because those buildings are going to get torn down. I think that's kind of interesting, right? They're going to go down, they'll become part of the architecture, the infrastructure, right? Do it with a big scale. And he liked that idea, and that was a fantastic project.
So you're putting you know, in this thing in Toronto, of course, property values is you know, a hot topic. Property is a hot commodity here, and I mean, you're right. We often speak about neighborhoods and housing in terms of their economic value, but these things are all about people. And in this in Regent Park, for example, you know, people are moving around, people get displaced. And that kind of, so you're kind of like repopulating or is it symbolic?
People were still living there.
Yeah.
When I took.
What I mean, but visually, you're going from
people
on buildings.
Yeah, yeah. So it's for that project in particular. What was interesting to me was, I've grown up in Toronto my whole life, so I was born here. Regent Park was never a place that was thought of or spoken of in any higher regard. Right? So a lot of stigmas associated with Regent Park. And when we developed the project for Luminato, we did some workshops with some Regent Park focus. And it kind of became apparent, like, that these, you know, put these portraits up, and who's going to come see them? Like, we need to invite people out to Regent Park, right? Which is kind of, now that's not a strange thing, because Regent Park is this new, redeveloped, beautiful space, right? Daniels has got an art center there.
You've got a significant public commission on the plaza there. We've seen some images of that go by.
But back then in 2008, it was like, you know, like, why are people going to come out there? It's like, well, let's put them out there. We have these portraits. We're going to invite people out. And we'll get these kids to do tours of the neighborhood. And it was really nice because a lot of people did come out because, you know, Luminato is a big festival. They have a big draw. And a lot of the remarks were like, you know, like, the people here are really nice. And it's like, well, of course, you know. in your neighborhood where you live, you know, it could be, I don't know in particular, but like if you're in Forest Hill or if you're in Roncesvalles or, you know, like wherever you are, there's people who are nice in your neighborhood, there's people who aren't nice. Everybody's, right?
Yeah.
And so that was kind of the idea, was to try and, by doing these works at these scale, first of all, yeah, you are, it's a juxtaposition against advertising because of the scale. And also because of who we're choosing to focus on, these people wouldn't be in advertising. And then for that
not project, the beautiful people.
Well, they are beautiful people, but they're not the beautiful people that advertise for sense, right? You know?
Yeah,
And it was really, you know, change some of the statements that were associated with what people thought of that neighborhood, you know? Like, I had great experiences there. Like, I'm working and people were bringing me food and, you know, if I just go to the bathroom, I was going to their house, use the water, like, you know, like, they were very welcoming to me. Like, I was there, and they were so happy that I was doing something to ignite or activate their space in their neighborhood, right? Like, and that's continued with other projects I've done in a similar vein, doing portraiture.
So, I'm starting to detect now when you're talking about, you know, skateboarding, there's a little bit about exploring space, and then the advertising, there's a little bit of subversiveness and the effect that advertising has on it. I'm talking about, you know, going into an area like Regent Park and trying to, you know, bring an identity to that area. Is there, can we say, street art might be your medium or category, but are you a social activist, Dan? Are you?
I guess
go that far.
At times, I could be.
Yeah.
I don't really necessarily like to pinpoint myself in any. I don't want to pigeonhole myself. So, like, I mean, you can see the images. I try and do different works, and use different materials. I kind of, you know. I work with what there's different people I have as clients. Okay? So my first client is me. When I started putting work on public space, that was my first client. So I did things that were like interesting to me. And then as I did that, the client became the city at large. Right? Like you get feedback on your work or like just noticing what's going on, paying attention, you want to make work that will interest people, right? And when I say interest, if you hate the work or love the work, that's the same level of interest because then at least you're engaging in it. It caused a reaction, right? And then through that, it became like getting clients like, some of the images came up here, like I did a project for Vespa, right? Commercial project.
Yeah, you've subverted some billboards of some large corporations and you've also been hired by some large corporations.
Yeah, just the one. Just Vespa.
Is it just Vespa?
Yeah, just Vespa.
Oh, okay, I thought there may have been some other ones.
But
you would do other ones, right? I mean, you're not, you have a...
No, it depends. It has to be the right feel and the right...
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, like the best one I did...
Big oil company?
I don't know. Yeah, I would...
Depends what it is.
Depends what it is. Like if they wanted me to do something where they like, I mean, to go cover, document the oil sands or something like that because they understood the value, like, hey, hold on, we fucked up, or like, this is interesting to document how the land's changed or something, right? Okay, but like with Vespa, I agreed to do that project because I thought scooters were a sensible way of traveling, but I also was interested in really playing with people's perception and not letting on there was a Vespa project at first. So putting all the work up and people thinking it was fantastic, but then we let it out of the bag that it was advertising. And then the same people who thought it was fantastic started to hate it.
The same people, would that be like people within the, what, art or street art community?
It could be street art community, could just be regular people who see the work. And I also wanted to play with the idea that like street art is advertising, graffiti is advertising. They're all born out of, like really, graffiti and street art are born out of advertising. You know, advertising is much older than both of these mediums, you know, contemporary. I know there was graffiti back on, you know, in the caves and...
Those were ads, actually.
They were ads.
Turns out they were ads,
right.
Yeah. Recent research.
On sale for, yeah. Caribou this week. So
it's interesting. So you've done let's say illegal work. You've also done art proper art gallery and art museum.
Yeah, I've even done legal work when I've had museum commissions. Like I did a project for the MOM where I documented homeless youth in Toronto. And we've seen some images where they wrote their own messages on these cardboard panhandling signage, right? Saying what they really would say if they had the opportunity instead of asking for money, right? And that was shown in the ROM, but then all the works out in the street, we didn't get permits for those. I just went and did those, and I insisted that I did that because I'm a street artist. Like, I'm a street artist, so that's part of my practice, and that it wouldn't make sense to go get a permit to go do those things.
So that, I mean, it's interesting. It's got to, you know, not every artist can, you know, can easily negotiate or participate in those worlds. Commercial gallery world, illegal work, legitimate commissions. Those are hard. I mean, you're explaining along the way some of your reasoning behind that, but I think it'd be difficult for people to hop between those worlds. You seem quite comfortable.
I think I said before, I don't really want to pigeonhole myself. So if an opportunity comes to me and I think it's right and there's a good reason to do it and it makes sense and there's, then I will, you know, I'll go for it, right? But I think navigating those worlds too is interesting because then it gives me broad spectrum or a broad sense of experience or experiences with these different ways that people perceive and present art. You know, so at MOCCA, you guys present art a certain, you present art, like, it changes, but you're an institution. So you're interested in, education, artistic merit, or in particular, contemporary art. Right? So how people are pushing the boundaries of materials or ideas, you know? So that's one way of presenting or looking at art, right? But a nonprofit, they might be interested in presenting art or disseminating it for their clientele, their base, in a different way, which is more like hands-on, where you're actually bring people from the community in to work on the project. You know, and those same people who are gonna do something with that nonprofit, now they might have some comfort going to MOCCA, you know, because there's not necessarily a fee, and you guys have a more relaxed atmosphere, right? But they might not feel comfortable going to the AGO or the ROM. You know, they might have gone to the ROM when they were a kid to see the dinosaur exhibit or something, but to go to the AGO when there's, you know, a show with panels with a lot of art speak on them, and you know, the work is so idea based, but there's not almost even an object or something, that might not be a comfortable space for them, right? So there's all these different people who present art, or the art, patrons, and it's really interesting for me to work with these different people because then I get, a more realistic sense, or just like I said, broader sense of what people think is art, you know, because art can be anything, and it means different things to different people. And by working in these different ways, I think I can maybe make projects that hopefully, and I'll always want to try and strive for that, and I can maybe reach that goal someday where it's a simple idea that can be appreciated by these different groups for different reasons. You know, I think the more and more I do my work, it's important for me to write about the work. You know, so I conceive the idea, and then I might want to write about it and really have a solid thesis behind why I'm doing it. But that thesis, I don't want it to be too much art speak, you know. I want it to be written well, but at the same time, it's got to be understood by a person who's not got a master's in museum studies or something.
Well, working out in public there, you got to wait. It's the broadest audience possible.
Yeah. Yeah, well, it all goes hand in hand, right? If I'm working with these different groups, then it's really forming.
So here's something, Dan, I don't mean to interrupt, but of course, I think I did promise that we'd get to talking about Sukaville. So we just saw an image there. That's you started working with, shall we say, found or appropriated.
Reappropriated.
Reappropriated sandwich boards, generally advertisements for condos.
Yeah.
When did you start that? When did you start
so
noticing or understanding or getting inspired to use that material?
So, okay, well, I started using the material back in 2008 when I did a city renewal project. That was the project on Lisgar. Which is was your impetus for commissioning the
game. Yeah, that's what it was. Yeah.
So I did this show with a good friend of mine, Gabriel Spector. We were given the opportunity to, we had a 5,500 square foot warehouse space on Lisgar that we're just, my best friend Matt Janice, his mother-in-law had a nonprofit there, and they had to move because this building was gonna be turned into a condo. So they had picked the lease for like the next 8 months, but they found a new space. So they moved, and she said, you know, we don't need any money, you can just, if you wanna do something, do something. So Gabriel and I came up with this idea to recreate a city block or elements of a city inside the space. And we're really interested in these mom and pop stores that were starting to disappear because there was a lot of development happening 2007, really, 2006, you know, like we're noticing these things. And some of these places were, you know, places where we would put our work on. We would go put our posters on or do whatever we're gonna do to these spaces because they were run down or like abandoned, right? So we documented them, we created these two scale storefronts in this space. And I started to use the material as to do all my framing. Because these condo boards were everywhere. We're like, well, we're doing this show, we've got the space for free. You know, it's a huge space, and like, you know, let's cut down some costs a little bit. Like, there's these signs, we can use them. And we thought, well, that kind of makes sense too, because they're gonna turn this building into a condo, and these stores are gonna disappear because of the gentrification, right? Like, there was something that made sense there. And it was really nice when we actually did some of the pieces, because they're black and white, you could see the condo ads through the paper a bit. So that was the first time. And then again, I used that material for the piece for MOCCA, for the defunct front. And then I had the idea that I wanted to use that material again to make some sculptures. And I don't remember how exactly the conversation happened, but Jess and I were talking, and the opportunity came to do, the opportunity was to be artist in residence for Luminato. And, you know, Jess put the question like to me, what do you want to do? And I said, well, I'm interested in using these condo boards to make sculptures. And I kind of want the sculptures to comment on the condo market. So Jessica said, okay, that sounds great. And I went out in a truck and got a lot of these sandwich boards, brought them back to my studio and started to make them.
Most of them I found out because we had a sandwich board. Moke had a sandwich board out on Queens. We built our own. We didn't reappropriate one, but of course, you know, city bylaw came around, and a lot of those sandwich boards are illegally placed.
Yeah. Of all the ones I've taken, there's a permit you can get for them.
Yeah.
And it lasts for a year or something, or 6 months, or different durations, and it's at a certain location that they put them. And they put a sticker on the board. I've only, you know, once I've gotten back to my studio, I've only had three boards that had the stickers on. Now, I didn't return them because I'd already done stuff with them, but just, you know, it's a super low percentage. Like, so,
again, you know, we're talking about the occupation of space. Now we're getting into, you know, the issue of, you know, we're talking about these projects in Regent Park. We're talking about housing, social housing, the condo market.
Yeah.
Now, I don't know how much I should be giving away about your piece for Sukaville, but can I mention? So, yeah. You have to go see it. It doesn't matter what I say. You're not going to get a good picture. You have to go. As I understand, you're making a suka out of the condo sandwich boards.
Yes.
And that's when, you know, during our conversation, it kind of clicked into me. I said, well, you know, a souk is a symbolic shelter.
Mm-hmm.
condo is a form of shelter, so I, is that?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. That was the reason why Nancy approached me, and affordable housing is, you know, everyone needs a place to live. People have different means as to how they can afford a place to live. For me, I think that there's not enough. I'm fine with condos. I would like to see them built better, because I think they're just going to turn into the new ghettos. You know, in 20 years, you can already see something like the windows falling out. If you've ever been to a condo that's about 7 or 8 years old, it's a little shabby.
Well, yeah, people do have to live somewhere. I'm not against condos, but I wish they'd put a little bit more interest into the design and the architecture. It would be nice.
For sure, and also maybe...
Doesn't make economic sense often, apparently.
No.
Spend too much on architectural design and materials.
Yeah, there also should be more, you know, social housing in condos. There should be more. Like in Regent Park, you know, they tore the social housing down, built these new buildings, and now it's like a 50-50, right? 50% social housing, 50% market rate. And they've really done a great job in trying to bring those communities together. And I can see from all the time I've spent there, especially with the Faces of Regent Park project I did install recently and I worked on for a while, that, you know, each group gets something from one another. You know, like if you live in a condo, you don't necessarily know all your neighbors because maybe you're single, everyone goes to their box. I don't know, if you've been in a building before, a high rise, people go to the elevator, they're kind of quiet. That community is not the same as low rise communities, right? But Regent Park, so when this development happened, there's the old community who really knew each other quite well, and then a lot of them come back, right? They got this place, they come back. And there's this new community or these new residents who don't necessarily know anybody. So like the new residents have kind of really, I've seen a lot of them, seen how to, or maybe not how to, just they see these other people acting this way, so they come back this way, right? Or they're more welcome to community events or having a community, right? And probably some of the people who moved there probably were interested because they knew that was that type of community, right? So they chose to live there for that reason. And then likewise, I think especially for young people in this mixed-use community, you see that they their world is much larger because the people who are now living in their community are much more diverse in terms of especially what they do for a living.
Yeah.
You know, their neighbors are now doctors, lawyers, engineer, architects, or you know, social work, whatever. Like they're expanded. They can see that, like, oh, well, you know, John down the street or whatever, John on my floor, he does this. I want to do that. I can do it. There's more of a.
So you're, I mean, again, I tried to, you know, slap the label social activist on you there a little earlier, Dan, but, you know, you tried to back away from that a little bit, but now I know you're very passionate to make a statement like everybody should have a place to live. Well, yeah, should they? What if they can't afford it? And of course, you know, this is, you know, it's timely in some ways to talk about this in a broader issue considering what's taking place in certain parts of the world. But the SUCA, again, it's a symbolic shelter, and then you're drawing attention to these issues of housing by, I think, by using, you know, you could build your SUCA out of something else.
It would have been a lot easier to use a different material because this half-inch plywood, you can only do, you know.
But another thing, too, I'm wondering, too, now I know there's certain, you know, within that, you know, tradition of the SUCA, there may be some fairly, you know, tight parameters around what that is supposed to be, how that's supposed to function. I'm wondering, you know, if you're building this thing that I think may have a potential for a larger statement of perhaps sneaking a little bit outside of the parameters, the traditional parameters of the SUCA, you don't know yet, you'll have to put it up, how that's going to be received. Or it's interesting to me, I think, so the people have invited you here, maybe they're taking a bit of a risk.
There could be a bit of a, I think anyone who works with me is probably to take a bit of a risk.
Yeah, I do recall that. I think you're still working on your piece at the opening, the facade there. That was a bit of a risk. But, maybe this is an appropriate time to open up to, questions to the floor, because I'm interested in that, if this gesture, if you will, is how this is going to be received. You're bringing your interest in social housing or the right to housing into this ancient tradition. Again, I think it's a bold invitation, but how you're going to respond to that, it'll be interesting to see how people how that'll be received. Are you getting any stress along the way?
I haven't felt any stress in terms of the choice of material. It seems kind of, well, maybe to me sometimes some things seem obvious I'm doing it, right? But to me it seems like an obvious smart choice of material. I'm not going to necessarily, once I build it, I'm not going to be there preaching to people. I do these things, and they're conversation starters. And I try and do things in a certain way where they don't hit you over the head too much. So they're like, there's levity, right?
Will you be using, other, plant matter, the hole in the roof,
no,
that
absolutely.
Kind of,
of course,
you're following the guidelines.
Yeah, I'm following the guidelines for sure. And the other approach that I'm taking to the sukkah is that, I think regardless of the holidays that you celebrate, religious, non-religious, whatever it is, your families get together, right? So families are like adults, kids, there's teenagers and stuff, but and there always ends up being the adult table and the kid table or something, right? Especially the larger they get, right? So this sukkah that I'm building is actually I'm building a sukkah for kids. That's my approach, because I looked at all the designs, and I didn't see that I was going to be adding anything especially in terms of the material I'm using, that I could do something super innovative in terms of shape per se. Because again, it's half inch plywood. There's only so many things I can do with it. So I got to go with the strength of this material, the fact that there's ads on them, there's these colors and stuff, so I can make things look very visually interesting. But then I thought, okay, well, who's going to go in this sukkah? Why would you go in this sukkah compared to another one? I was like, well, I have young kids. And I was like, well, none of these sukkahs are directed at kids. And I really noticed that. You notice that when you have kids, what's directed at kids and what kids are allowed to do. And it's like, well, why don't I make it, since it is going to have a fun aesthetic in terms of some of the patterns I might create and stuff, why don't I make a sukkah for kids? And then that got me kind of thinking of small spaces or forts. And I remember when we talked before,
in a neighborhood I was growing up, there was sukkahs, of course. We always saw them as, we just call them, forts.
Yeah.
We love playing in those things every year. We all go in a little, small plastic thing, and they're kind of epic in our imaginations at the time.
So I thought, if I can work with that idea or extend that and make it for kids, then, it's something that not everybody else is doing, and it's, they're a huge part of our community, right? So they, I don't want to say, it might sound kind of silly, kids need a sukkah too, right?
Everybody needs housing.
Yeah, well, exactly. So, and then you're just, then you kind of, and it might not go this far when I'm building, when the actual structure is there, but you start thinking of micro condos, because I'm building something that's kid size in a way, right? And it's hold on, I'm just it's a micro condo or something, I'm that's housing too, right?
There's going to be some developer picking up on that idea, Dan. That's going to be the next step in Toronto is going to be micro condos, and you were the guy that invented that.
Well, I didn't invent it.
No, I think they did. They have in Tokyo,
Vancouver, there's a lot of micro condos in Vancouver. Yeah.
Actually, some of the ones I've seen out on Queen West, I'd call them micro condos.
Yeah, conversation.
How are we doing just for time? I
think we could do questions.
Yeah, I'm is there any questions out there. I mean, he says, well, there we go. There's some people out there. Got the glaring lights on me here. Anybody have any questions for, well, Dan's the artist. I'm just firing questions at him. Don't ask me anything. I haven't seen the plans for the suit yet. I don't know what he's making.
Have you had like a big problem with the police when you were like doing your work?
No, never.
I've
never had any
really
issues.
Oh well.
I just try and blend in. So I just do my thing, you know, and like,
yeah.
I mean, there's sometimes I swear I thought I was gonna get busted. Like a recent billboard I did. I was up on the billboard. And I'm doing these new billboards where I'm scraping, instead of like putting anything on the billboard, I'm scraping the billboards, I'm scraping the paper to make text within the billboard.
Yeah.
So they take a while. They take like 4 to 5 hours to scrape these things. So I'm up there doing it, and I looked across the street, and there was like 3 cop cars and an ambulance. And I'm like, it's car wash. And I'm like, well, maybe self car wash. Someone have a heart attack while they're watching the crowd. So I'm just like, well, I'm just gonna keep working. So ambulance leaves, and it's like one cop car leaves, and like there's still 2 cop cars, and like I'm like dead on in their view. But you know.
Well, that's funny. When I asked you, I kind of assumed you work at night, but that's just gonna call attention. It's
yeah.
Like, who's putting up? Who's nobody's working on billboards?
No, it's overtime.
Right?
Yeah,
yeah.
You don't pay for overtime for that. So yeah, I generally. Never had any issues, so I mean,
just act like you know.
Yeah, I'm lucky, but also just, you know, if you carry that confidence in to doing something like that, it's like if you want to sneak into a concert or something, you know, like there's probably a good way to there's a good way to sneak into the concert and a bad way.
Yeah.
You know, the bad way would be like there's everyone lined up with their tickets and you just try and barge through, like you're not getting in. But if you go around the back and like you have like a black jacket that says crew on it or something or whatever, you know, and you have the right pose, and you know, like, you could probably get in the door, right?
Yeah.
Or like, you get on the phone while you're about to go through the door, like, oh, they don't have the lights set up yet. Oh, you know.
Yeah.
So you just kind of play the part.
Well, yeah, and you become, again, you're talking about it. I know from other, you know, other skateboarders I've talked to, I mean, they're very sensitive about the urban environment. They know how to read the environment, not just the architecture, but the people. I mean, they're really looking at that. I mean, a lot of us, you know, we do go about our movements within the city and, you know, to and from work. You know, a lot of that stuff just becomes kind of background to us, I guess, whereas, you know, skateboarders, street artists, guys like you really understanding what's going on in the city, you know, how things are built, where they go, who builds them, who pays for them, you know, who's moving around, and the different movements. So I suppose, you know, you're kind of more, you know, sensitive to how the
that's your
wheelhouse. That's where you work.
That's where I work, and yeah, I study all those things. And like whenever I go and install something too, I just don't go and do it. You know, I'll go and look at the spot, take photos of it, might hang out for a bit to see like who's around this area, who's doing stuff, you know? Just sit in my car or like sit on, you know, sit on the bench and just kind of watch to see like what's actually happening here. And I make notes, I measure everything. Like I have everything down like so that when I'm gonna go install it, I have a list. And it's like I go over the list and I bring the list with me in my pocket, and it's, you know, just like you would if you were gonna go and do the job anyway, and
yeah,
you know. But I'm very meticulous, so that I do everything in a certain order, so that I'm going to take the least amount of time, be the most efficient, test things out, you know, because you don't want to like go there and there's an accident. You don't want to have an accident or like not do forget something. It's there's a lot more that goes into these things than
not just some crazy guy decides jumping on a billboard there.
Yeah, for sure. You want to like go climb. Before I go to the billboard, I'll figure out how am I going to get up there. Do I need to get a couple ladders because I got to climb up onto the building and then I got to climb up onto the billboard, you know? And if I don't have the right ladder, I guess I got to go buy that ladder, right? So I'm like, you got to have all the equipment to do these things. But that's part of what I've determined my job is. You know, I've determined that these are things I'm going to do. So.
Yeah.
I just wanted to, the fun element of your sukkah that we're actually going to get selfie sticks, and because I'm sure it's going to be an incredible photo op, you know, for people like to, you know, kids in particular to want to be seen in it and have their picture taken in it. But I want to talk about how you feel about the temporary nature of some of your work, seeing it like on the Regent Park walls. Well, it's only going to be there until the building gets demolished. Mm-hmm. How do you feel about seeing your work destroyed in a way?
So a lot of that work, like Regent Park project in particular, those are photographs, right?
Yeah.
They're portraits of people. So when you put work in public space, it's, you know, space is constantly changing. With portraits, like people were constantly changing. So I took that photo, I would take that portrait of somebody, and that's only 1/125th of a second. That's how long the duration was for me to photograph them, which is nothing, right? And I'm fine. Like it's paper on the building. You know, I'm fine with it decaying. There's something that's kind of poetic about that, I think. Especially with that project, the purpose was for the work to go down with the building. There's certain pieces that I wish would last longer that didn't, you know, and like some of these billboards or some, you know, I spent all this time in doing it. I do get a photo of it, which is how it's going to definitely be documented for the ages, but yeah, they don't last. Like this piece in particular, that wall is beautiful. Right, I thought it was amazing. It tells the story of what was happening in this building, right? That wall is now covered with vinyl siding, the whole wall. It looks like crap. Brown vinyl siding. But there's like, you know, so I really didn't like what that one was kind of. But it's kind of the nature of the beast, and the more I've done this work, I've learned to live with it, and appreciate it and realize that's the, you know, part of what it is, right? Because as soon as I put it up, someone can come along and do whatever they want to it, right? So you have to kind of walk away from it. But then some of my work's changing a bit now that I'm getting more like larger public art commissions that are permanent. But even when they're permanent, they can still be damaged. One of the pieces in Regent Park that I did was damaged. So it's kind of the nature of doing things in public space. Things will decay, or people, you know, will vandalize them. Or it could just be like a car crash into one of the sculptures or something.
Another question.
Yeah, it just passed, but the Gatsby project,
yes.
That's kind of like visually similar to the Regent Park project.
Yeah.
Were you invited there, or what's the story behind that?
So there's they have a photography festival there. I think it's now they just had their fourth or fifth installment of it. So when I went, I think that was the second year they did it. So basically they have, I think there's like 17 towns that they do maybe an installation in, or have like a gallery opening. The curator heard about my work. He was in Toronto and he met with me, and he said, you know, he offered me, like, there's this town, Chandler.
Yeah.
I think you could probably do something there. And I said, okay, you know, so I did some research, and there was a pulp and paper mill that had closed down. So, you know, it made immediate sense to me, like, well, what about the people, right? So I always think about that. It's part of my practice. So I went up there, and I met with a lot of the former workers, and I shot portraits of them and put their images on the, you know, infrastructure of the mill. That was a fantastic project for so many different reasons. I'm putting photographs on the building, but you know, it has a certain aesthetic, and it's, you know, it's street art. There is no street art.
Yeah,
graffiti.
It's middle of nowhere. It's
right.
It's
a 17.5-hour drive from Toronto, and really that was the most efficient way to get there. The other way I could have gone would have been to like fly to Quebec City, wait a day, and then take a small plane to this like little town, and then rent a car. I'm like, that doesn't make any sense. I'll just drive there, right? And I'll bring away equipment and stuff. Yeah, so I went up one time and met with all these former workers and got like a, you know, tour of the mill and went back, made all the work, and then I returned to install everything. But what was really interesting with that project is that, like, again, like, I try and, this really, like, led me to think about, like, how deep I could engage a viewer, and really want, I really maybe challenged myself with that project, too, that in a way that's not seen by writing about it, and writing about it for myself, and also as a way to, you know, hopefully then share that writing with people who, you know, see the work later on my website. Or, so that mill was closed in 1999 after being open since 1915. And then in 2004, they reopened. And they had $400 million given to them by the Quebec and federal governments to try and reopen this mill, new equipment, all these things, right? Well, they stayed open for a couple of years and they couldn't compete and they closed. So then the mill, this Vietnamese firm approached the owners, and they bought the mill for $30 million. So they just spent $400 million on it, and then these guys come along and buy it for $30 million, but they have no interest in opening the mill in Chandler, in Gaspé. They take it apart, and they put it on a ship, and it's perfect because this is right on the ocean, right, the sea, St. Lawrence, and they just put it on a big boat, and they take all the stuff back, right? So it's like, you know, you're getting into all these different things like globalization, global economy. By the mill closing down, is like all these families, there's like a alcoholism and drug abuse increased to, like, I don't even know what the percentage was, but like, multifold. A lot of divorce because this was probably kind of traditional, Catholic, it's Northern Quebec, right, where mom's at home, dad works, mom takes care of the kids, that type of, setup. So, well, now dad lost his job, so he's going to go work somewhere else, and it's miles away, and this wreaks havoc on the family, they end up getting a divorce. All these things are happening in town, right? So by me putting the portraits up was really to kind of like recognize the history of labor in the community and make a lot of tourists go there, they don't know about what's happened, right? So some of the panels that we put up kind of explain the history of the site, and also for the people, so they have a sense of pride in themselves that, like, they did build this town, and they did a lot of good work in this space, right? So they could reclaim the mill. And then a whole other level was that, like, this Vietnamese company, they were ordered to rehabilitate the land. That's not maybe the best word. Decontaminate the site.
Remediate.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Thank you. They don't do that in Vietnam. So they weren't interested in doing that. So it was interesting when I actually went to do the photographs and work on the project, they hadn't got all the equipment out, but the town was blocking this Vietnamese company from accessing the site until they could get a remediation agreement in place. And I had to negotiate. The town wanted me to do it, and the owners, the Vietnamese owners, had to write them a letter to ask if I could put these images on the building. And they said yes, luckily, because they thought it was interesting, but like it was like this whole, like, I didn't know, I shot the portrait, like, are they going to let me on site because they're being blocked from it? Because technically they could say no to me, even though they can't access it themselves, the town people would probably just let me go on it, right? But there was all these legal things. So it's really like a lot of different narratives.
So the art's a catalyst for a whole series of conversations.
Yeah, exactly, right? So, and like, you could really get deep into looking at that town and what's going on by maybe being sparked by seeing one of the images, right? So for some person, they might want to go super deep. Other person might just be like, that looks cool, I get what he's doing, great, they stop there. So that, I think I've kind of mentioned that before, really, if I can put out simple ideas that are, multi-tiered in terms of your ability to engage in them, I think that's a successful way of creating public art.
As good artists do. Uh, How we doing there? Any questions? We wrap that up now, and now everybody's all stoked to go and see Dan's project at Sukaville, which is this weekend, right?
Next weekend.
Next weekend.
The 25th to 27th.
Right. Kind of lost track of time.
Well,
Dan, thank you very much. I hope that was interesting. And
whenever you've had document, that's what it is.
Yeah.
Hi, Dan. Hi.
I introduce myself.
Yeah, great, thanks.
So,
yeah, hope that turned out all right. Yeah.
Yeah, that was good.
Yeah, it was all right.
Yeah, that was
yeah,
good.
Okay, good.
Right,
felt okay.
Yeah, no pressure. No pressure.